When you talk about technology movement, you would see that in history of solar cell, you know, bifacial mode or bifacial 2015, 16, you know, when people started actually realizing, okay, this is something where we want to move ahead. Okay, so, you know, as of now, what we feel as a module manufacturer is that the market needs to shift, you know, from INR per watt peak to INR per kilowatt hour. You know, people need to realize, they need to overcome that barrier of price constraint, say that, you know, ye itne mein mil raha hai, poly 18 rupees hai, ye 18.5 hai, nahi yaar, I will not take mono. So, you know, China has completely moved to mono plug because they have already realized the advantage, efficiency advantage, and you go online and you search for studies, you will get technical studies, you will get commercial studies which says, you know, agar aap per ki baat karein to there is LETIDS, as Mr. Praveen pointed out, you know, LETID aaya, you know, per had a setback. But then when you look on to studies and see what is the actual effect of LETID, you would see that, you know, not only your module is degrading, but it is also, you know, regenerating back. So, you know, at the end of the day or at the end of, you know, when the module gets to or reaches its end of life, you will see that you are still getting, you know, that extra energy. So, you know, that is where the market needs to move. You know, from INR per watt peak to INR per kilowatt hour, because at the end, you know, that is where the money is. It's not in INR per watt peak.
Thanks, Kavish. Now, moving to a few points, I think Anand has already given us some homework. I think we need to cover safeguard duty. So, we are having, in our low cost country manufacturer, we are having all domestic manufacturer. So, I would like to ask my good friend Acharan, that how safeguard duty has impacted them or benefited them. So, please put some light on that.
Specifically, if I talk about sunshine, I don't think safeguard has impacted us at all. We were the largest module supplier last year. But, yeah, after the safeguard. Yeah. No, that is combined. After the safeguard, we supplied around 400.
So, it is not a limit.
For us, not. But, yeah, I mean, more or less, it's a personal opinion that I don't think safeguard was a precisely right decision. I mean, you can always argue about it, but with the kind of capacities we are adding installation days, say last year, even after safeguard, the installation days was around 7 gigawatts, 6.7 or 7 gigawatts. With our manufacturing capacities in India at around 2.5, 3 gigawatts, not more than that probably, with the top 3, 4 players. For the top 2 players.
No, not very
total, but I mean, there are. But how many?
I'm saying, basically,
it's to
say that
it's
not impacted.
Not exactly. Yeah, it has not impacted me, but. I don't think personally it was a, you know, very wise decision to go with safeguard. With always a question mark around the quality also with the Indian manufacturers apart from the top 4-5, and with the question mark, I would say, I'm not aware of the capacity that we have standing in India right now for the domestic manufacturers, but there is still a question mark about what exactly is the capacity of the domestic manufacturers. So. It was not an entirely wise decision, but yeah, it has helped Indian manufacturers quite a lot.
Certainly, safeguard duty helped Indian manufacturers, although there was no impact on the price because on same level prices came down, and that's the reason my colleague they did the business in India. But it helped to keep the prices intact. And I think it benefited to Indian manufacturing.
I think I would agree with Deepak sir and say that, you know, it has a little bit of positive impact, but not so much. I think it's just a little positive impact because, you know, at the same time when you had safeguard duty, you know, the prices of your solar cells had reduced drastically. So, you know, at the end, all in Indian conditions, you know, still we are. Where we have a market which is driven by cost, I think the impact was slightly positive. That is something what I believe.
I think beyond the pricing, pricing is actually a very tricky thing, you know. Before safeguard, the module prices from China was around 29 cents. After safeguard, it became 24 plus 5. The argument is the same. Maybe you should be able to tell us what is the secret behind this. But that apart, I think what has made a difference, you know, is that, you know, before safeguard, Indian manufacturers were dominantly supporting the rooftop market and the small distributed market. Safeguard perhaps has helped them graduate them into a large grid-oriented manufacturer or supplier, be it people like Huawei or Renesas or Vikram or Adani. For the first time, they entered in a very large way. You know, I worked also in some module manufacturer, but never I'd heard that, you know, somebody supplied 50 megawatts, 100 megawatts to a single project from a domestic manufacturer.
Thank you, Praveen. I think you took out some good points. See, I think for every industry to survive, there has to be something for the domestic. And if you will appreciate that every country today is safeguarding their domestic manufacturers, some or the other way. And possibly what my personal view is that, you know, safeguard has helped that for Indian module manufacturers. I am not saying that, you know, we are now, able to charge more, because ultimately it is the customer, you know, which drives the industry. It is the customer who demands the pricing. But today, yes, at least people have started looking at domestic manufacturers seriously, because till now it was, as he mentioned rightly, that it was only the distributed segment which was being catered by the domestic manufacturer. And people were not even entertaining you. Yes, today also there are a lot of challenges like tier one, which is you go to top five developers, I think they are going to ask you tier one, bankability, IC three times. I'm sure that they have their prerequisites, but then at least they've started looking at Indian manufacturers, and probably that is one of the reasons that domestic manufacturers have upgraded themselves. I think that is a most important point which I need to put forward. I think you talk about the top five manufacturers today are almost touching gigawatt facility. I think where in past have we seen such facilities in India? And that too, you see, all the latest of the equipments are coming today in India. So what we are saying that yes, safeguard duty per se is basically definitely supported the domestic industry by way of, you know, giving them chance to participate in the bigger sector, bigger play. And yes, the responsibility still lies, you know, because ultimately onus on all of us together is to be grid parity, you know. So I'm sure that, you know, we are part of that and we are playing our role. But at the same time, there has to be something left for domestic manufacturers. Thank you. But then now see, now this is leading us to some other thing, you know, which is we are talking about certifications. You see, we talked about safeguard. But now today we have created a entry barrier, you know, which is BIS. So we are talking now about certification, moving to other a topic, which is certification. And when we talk about certifications, I think today for global manufacturers, there is a benchmark created, which is BIS. Anybody and everybody globally has to pass through that if they want to do business in India. So I would like to ask upon similar, you know, question to my good friend, you know, from low-cost country and domestic, that what do you feel that is it a good move, or what do you suggest that now should have been done, something better way to deal with? So your comments on that. Thank you.
So my company is from low-cost country, not totally me. I still belong to India. No. BIS is a good enough step with its own glitches. Whatever happened. Every country, be it Australia or Japan, has put in some technology in place to, you know, check upon the quality of modules being imported in the country, because there is a dumping which was going on. There was a dumping going on from larger manufacturers, which is no doubt, which you can't argue upon. So it is, you know, a decent step in the right direction, I would say. And though it came a little late, but yeah, I mean, I don't think nobody would deny the fact that it is a good step in the right direction.
If we see most of the big markets worldwide, they have certification in place. Like if we go to Brazil, they have Inmetro. If we go to Japan, they have JET. MCAC is there, CEC is there. So yeah, UL is there. So likewise, we adopted BIS. Certainly, that is very good move by our ministry. Only thing is, I would like to suggest that it should be stringently checked on whatever imports is happening or whatever modules manufactured domestically. They should check it thoroughly so that there should not be there should not be any say running away from the quality from the manufacturers.
Yeah, BIS is a good move. I think it's a good move to start with. You know, I don't think it's the end. You know, the problem what we found in this BIS is it just copies IEC. It doesn't do anything at all. If you read the BIS specification, it says follow IEC 61215. Now, IEC by and large has been made to take care of the European environment and, as Kavish said, sort of qualification test. So when a system is being put into India, I think they should have made it slightly more climatically adaptive compared to, you know, simply copying it. That would have really strengthened the quality norms here. Not just about what the Indian manufacturers do, also what you produce in China and you get into India. Now that's the biggest pitfall. And also I think the second issue about BIS is it still follows the older version of IEC and not the newer version. So people again have to get it done once another amendment comes in. So yeah, bottom line, it's a good move, but could have been better. Anyhow, it's not too late. I hope, you know, forums like this will take up and, you know, make it more stringent. More stringent in the sense, just make it more suitable to a climatic situation. Lot of parts in the country are high in heat and high in humidity. Very large coastline, high humidity. Most of the, you know, above Hyderabad upwards, I think it's all high temperatures in most part of the year. So need to make the Indian specification more Indian specific. I think that's the point.
I think all my points are being covered. You know, whatever I had back in my mind has been covered by all the panelists here. But then, yes, BIS is a good move. I would like to agree with all the panelists. You know, better late than never. It's always better to have something, you know, barring, you know, bad quality or something which is not of a good quality, you know, entering into your market. Because at the end, you want the modules to be working for 25 years. You do not want something to, you know, go out of line, because there are lot and lots of capex which enters, which goes into the, you know, putting up a solar power plant. You have lot of PSUs, you have lot of industries who are relying on that single power plant. So you really do not want something to go bad or be deferred up before, say, 25 years, maybe within 15 years or 20 years. So I think BIS is a good move, but I would like to, you know, agree with Mr. Hande that, you know, something better could have been done with BIS, because, you know, Indian conditions, if you see, it is basically divided into 5 or 6 climatic zones. And if you copy directly something from IEC, I think that really doesn't, you know, it really doesn't help the Indian market. So that is not my point.
One funny part I would like to add, which is happening worldwide, modules being asked with certification, but there is no certification for cells. Similarly, on warranty sides, cells, there is no warranty. Cell manufacturers, they are not offering any warranties. But from module manufacturers, 25 years, now even people are offering 30 years. And it is expected that people may ask for 50 years.
So you have pitched ekdam sahi jagah pe aapka nishana ho
gaya. So I think, you know, I thank the panel, first of all, to acknowledge the fact that BIS is a good move. Because for any government to implement something is not that easy. Because there are sections they cannot satisfy a particular section. They have to satisfy every. There are 160 manufacturers in India, module manufacturers I'm talking about. You can go to MNRE website and check it. I think they need to satisfy everybody and they have to make a start. So I think it is a good start, but yes, we have challenges ahead. I'm sure that we are catching up and the things are going to be upgraded, because what we are saying is this is an entry point. We are not saying that the certifications are no more valid. I think you go to any developer, they are going to still ask you 61215, 61730, 61701, 62716, 62804, salt mist, you name any, you know, sand abrasion test. They are definitely going to ask you all other tests as well. But what we rightly mentioned, that this is a entry. Though they have created a barrier, entry barrier, which by which they have put everybody in the same platform. So I'm sure that, you know, I'm sure we all agree that it's a good move. So talking more about now, you know, we have seen this industry, you know, in the morning session, we were talking about the prices, you know, the PPA prices were somewhere in the range of 18, almost a decade and a half back. And during those times, the price of solar module used to be $4 per watt. Today, we are seeing the PPAs in the range of 2.44, and the module price is dropping down to 26, 27 cents odd. I'm talking about domestic manufacturer price inclusive of safeguard duty. So I would like to ask the panelists, you know, what is their view on the pricing and where they see the price may further go down to?
I don't think so there will be any further reduction in the prices, because if we see the news about the polysilicon, so there is an increase in polysilicon prices. So ultimately it will reflect in wafers, then cells and on modules. So I think it will be a little bit on the upward side, not on the downward side.
So as far as price reductions any further, I mean, I don't think it is any more possible. I mean, in which case, if these prices, most of the, you know, poly manufacturers now are, you know, it's very difficult for them to even survive. That is one reason for major shift to monopod, not the push towards monopod. This new technology will bring more profitability to the organization. Yeah, but the gap between them will reduce certainly within the upcoming months. So, just one point I wanted to make, as sir rightly pointed out, the prices before safeguard were around 30, 31 cents and then suddenly came down to 24, 25 cents. The percentage of reduction was same as the safeguard duty. So, it's just not possible for any supply chain to be so efficient in such a short duration of time. So there are certainly undercuttings in the products which have happened. The glass thickness has come down, the frame thickness has come down, the cable length has come down. So yeah, I mean, it's ultimately, you get the same product what you pay for. So people have compromised, but yeah, further price reduction, I don't see any chance of further price reduction now.
What I think is, you know, every technology comes with a price. You see, when you pointed out about PoE or TPO, when you say you need half-cut based cells, or when you need bifacial cells, when you need bifacial modules, what I feel is, I think, you know, the prices may go up. That is what I feel. Because, you know, every technology comes with a cost. You know, you cannot ask for a better technology and say, you know, I want the same price. So, you know, you have to give little bit margin to the module manufacturers as well. And being said that, this is what I feel.
Thank you, Kavish. I think, you know, what I personally feel, you know, prices is dominated by the drivers. It is the demand supply situation. I think what we were referring to a decade and a half back, when the prices were $4, the manufacturing cost, over a period of time, your manufacturing cost reduced because you have already amortized your, you know, costs. So during those times, I think the polysilicon went, because of the demand supply situation, the polysilicon went up to $350 per kg. Today, we are seeing less than $10. So, of course, there are some process optimization they might have done. But then it is majorly the demand supply which has actually reduced the cost. It is the economies of scale which has reduced the cost. When we talk about Indian prices vis-a-vis import pricing, I think I would like to make some few points here. Because see, there is always going to be a delta between import and the domestic. The reason is very, very clear. First being the economies of scale, which India is definitely catching up. So I say that, you know, we give a benefit of doubt to us now. It is the cost of finance. It is the inbuilt supply chain. It is the supply chain cost, basically when you, logistics. Because when we import, see, we are depending today. We are depending on less, you know, below cell, we are totally depending on them. So whatever safeguard duty, even if we are putting safeguard duty on cells, the prices of wafer will go up. So you are actually going to average it out some other way. So basically what we feel that, you know, because of all these reasons, cost of finance, export benefits which the other countries are providing, including your individual supply chain, logistics cost, I think couple of cent is difference in price is always going to stay unless we built in the complete value chain in-house. I think this is what my personal view is. So we have also talked about pricing. So quickly, I think, you know, we also wanted to touch upon the new technologies in place, which are half cut, bifacial, and multi-bus bar technologies, as you know, we have spoken a little bit about. I think I would like, you know, the panel to little bit, you know, explain it more and also put a insight whether these are going to stay for long or these are, you know, some short term, you know, measures.
So industry already is on the shifting mode from poly and mono to monopore, and in fact polypork is also again expected in the market. Apart from that, there is a shift. It's very niche market, but there is a half-cut cell modules, and certainly fibre bus is now the main. It is in mainstream, but there are multi-bus bar modules are coming. Then multi-wire technology is coming. If cost permits, then certainly there is a huge demand is predicted in Indian market as well. But it will be dependent on the cost of production and the size of production.
I guess already more or less people are aware of half cut. I mean, I guess polypork being the initial product bought by others in the Canadian and half cut. So people are more or less aware about half cut. The same platform is being implemented for monopack also by, I guess, Jinko and a few other players, 390 and 395 product. Bifacial has been in existence since long, but I really don't see any benefit behind that, and it has not picked up the way it should have. But at the end of the day, it is like it's not about who's adopting what, who's manufacturing it at a commercial scale with you know, lesser rejection rates, you know, at a sustainable margin. So that is how it is going to be driven by, and further going on, you know. The new and advanced technologies are going to play more and more important part. The only impact or the you know disadvantage I see that the life cycle of these products or innovations is very small. I mean, today we are talking about monopack, probably next year we'll be talking about some other thing in maybe 430 or 420 40, which already people are coming up. So as sir rightly said, there is no time to really, you know, see the performance of the product or the durability of the product in longer run, as we have done with the polycrystallines or the or little bit with the monocrystallines.
Yeah, yeah. When you want to see a technology adoption, just localizing it to India, you will not really get a full picture, especially when you take technologies like bifacial. Bifacial. Hardly anybody is, you know, adopting in India. There are some, you know, reference projects which are being done. That's a test batch, like 2 megawatt, 3 megawatt, just to compare. But I think globally, yeah, it's really picking up. In fact, recently, one project in Jordan, 100 megawatts bifacial is going on, and it's being done by an Indian company, a reputed Indian EPC organization. So we are seeing bifacial, you know, picking up quite well, especially in the Middle East, where you have a sand as a base. And if you have sand as a base, your albedo is better. So your generation is expected to be, you know, much better when compared to a plain land where grass blows and all, you know. DuPont also is sort of involved in the bifacial thing. We normally people use glass and glass because you need transparency at the back. So we are bought out with a transparent back sheet. The advantage of which are like you don't need to change your manufacturing process. Glass to glass, your manufacturing has to be tweaked to take the glass on the other side. Whereas if you want to use a normal back sheet and a transparent back sheet, the same line can take care of it. Some lamination advantages also. And also some amount of higher power generation we have observed because of lower cell temperature when compared to glass. This is going to pick up. If you want this to pick up in India, it's by and large more, you know, the large tender which government is planning in Jammu and Kashmir, the Leh Ladakh thing. That's where you get the base as snow. And the moment you have a snow as a base, your albedo will go up. So that's one place. You know, maybe we'll have to wait till that time for the bifacial market in India to go up. But when it comes to half-cut cells, yeah, we've seen a lot of adoption. Again, simply because we see from a cost perspective and half-cut cells apparently gives better generation when there is a shadow. Typically, shadow does happen early mornings and late evenings, one row or the other kind of a situation, as well as some slight power generation because of lower I2R losses. So things are happening, yeah, but we are like cost-oriented. But it will come in a day, if not today, maybe, you know, over a period of time when suitability factors in.
I think I would agree with Mr. Hane, because what happens in bifacial is you need a land or you need a surface which has higher albedo factor. Now, when you consider India, you know, barring Jammu and Kashmir, you do not have lands which has higher albedo factors. So, you know, that is something you may need in surface upgradation. You may need to, you know, maintain that surface, you know, for the period of your lifetime of your module, you know, for 25 years. So that is something what is important. But on the other hand, on technology wise, when you see a half-cut cell based module, you see you get direct advantages of, say, I2R losses, which are reduced by 1/4. You get better performance in shading. So, you know, you can have a tighter row, inter-row spacing between the module, and you know you get the extra gain of, you know, power output from your the same area. You know, you do have lot of other advantages added to it. You know, lower NMOT, nominal module operating temperature. You have higher backseat spaces, which, you know, enhances your light reflectivity, and then you get extra power output. So I feel half-cut cells may have a direct impact, or you know they can be used directly on and replace maybe the full cell modules in maybe next few years. But then bifacial is something what we'll have to see. As I pointed out, you know, Jammu and Kashmir is a, you know, a key area where, you know, you can apply bifacial or apply maybe a half cut bifacial, you know, which is a higher upgraded version, and then you can reap the maximum benefits out of it. Because at the end, as a customer, if you see, you do not want to pay for something and you if you cannot avail the advantages. So, you know, that is what my perspective is.
I think I would fully agree with the panelists. I think, you know, half cut is the way which we also feel that, you know, is looking very promising. And the reasons are already explained, that it definitely gives you a 2 to 3% higher generation over a full cell module of the same area. And of course, for bifacial, I think it is the subsurface which matters, because the reflectivity has to be very, very high. And that's why, you know, we all are with the same wavelength, that, you know, it is the area, the location where the surface gives a very good reflectivity is going to be the best place to install it. Definitely a lot of installations globally are happening recently. You know, there is a company called Sketech who has already executed 65 megawatt in South Africa. I think a lot of global installations are happening. In fact, you know, what Mr. Pavina was also mentioning, that, you know, they have something which is transparent. I think we as a backsheet component level manufacturers also have a bifacial module with a transparent backsheet, not a glass to glass, but glass to backsheet, transparent backsheet with a frame. So today, you know, because when we talk about bifacial, people have been using it glass to glass because of the transmittivity. But then today we also have that, you know, it's our in-house developed product. These are promising technologies, but you know, basically it will depend on where are you going to deploy it. Based on that, the success factor is going to come out. I think, you know, time is not permitting us, you know, because I think, you know, this is, as I mentioned, that solar module is what generates rest all components in your module manufacturing plant, either converts, controls or monitors. So I think, you know, we are sitting in the right industry. That's what I feel. And you know, possibly next time we'll have a full day session on solar modules, because there is a lot we can speak about solar modules. And if we can control, I would not say quality, because quality is something which is perceived by individuals. I think individual companies, I mean to say, but it is the reliability, the product reliability, which you have to build in your product. And that's where the manufacturers have to play a key role. So with that, I think I would close the session. Thank you so much, all the panelists, you know, and most importantly, all the participants, because you know, it's very, very difficult. You know, I rarely, you know, you might have heard that 6:30 people are sitting and hearing the panel discussions, you know. So thank you so much to you all. And most importantly, thanks to the EQ team, because you know, we are talking that, you know, it is a late this, that. I think, you know, they have been starting very early because they have to plan the whole day and they are sitting here. So thank you, EQ team, for organizing such a wonderful show today. I think all credit goes to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rao. I would like to thank you all the panelists and speakers who have contributed their valuable time today. With this, we are coming to an end to the PV Investec series from Surcon, Mumbai. And would request Mr. Rawat to present a moment of token to co-panelists.